Okay. It was already, the table was already in here, so I just like.
I would just call this meeting to order since we have a quorum and those are fleeting. The first order of business is hazardous mitigation plan update.
Which we seem to have in front of us.
Well, good evening, everybody. Mr. Chairman, I have members of the board. My name is Sam Cleaves. I'm a regional planner with the Metropolitan Area Planning Council and I'm working with the town of Reading. Who's contracting with us to do a pre-disaster mitigation plan update. And this is the first opportunity for folks, basically. I'm just gonna give a quick overview of what the process is, tell you what we're doing. It is an opportunity that Julie's been giving out for Gene and a whole bunch of folks hoping that they would come out. But typically, we don't get a large turnout for this, but I can tell you what we're doing. And we would welcome your input into the plan as well. So it's a sort of a one-year process. We began a couple of months ago. And Reading is doing this plan update under federal law, under the Federal Disaster Mitigation Act. We have to redo these plans every 5 years in order for communities to continue to be eligible for mitigation grants. These are fairly large uncapped grants. It's the plan sort of gets you in the door and then you can go after these grants. They are very useful for everything from building seawalls to bridges to other, usually they're infrastructure related in this part of the country,
right?
Because we deal with a lot of flooding in this area. Of course, you know Reading and other areas. I've worked in communities all around you redoing these plans, and everybody's in the same watershed. Some people are higher and some people are lower within it. So we Reading did their plan with us in 2010, so we're sort of in the process of updating, getting you back, getting it approved again, and then obviously doing this will fulfill that obligation and continue to go forward. Hopefully they're very useful and it brings the departments together to talk about different areas. We work with fire and conservation planning, emergency management, to take a look in particular with DPW and road service folks to look at what floods and where, what kind of brush fires we get, areas that have been damaged from previous storms. We've got microbursts and high winds, which is becoming more and more common. And we're able to map it out and actually provides a decent reference for local folks to use going forward. So reduction and prevention of loss of life, injuries of property, hazard mitigation. What actions are being taken now? What are your current mitigation actions? And then what actions could be taken in the future? Basically, that consists of identifying areas where the town and folks in town have identified where their problems. Again, in eastern Massachusetts, that usually revolves around water. And that's the case in Reading, as it is in many other communities. So in the 2010 plan, the state did their own plan. The state does its own plan, I should say. Typically, these are done by counties as well, but because we're in Massachusetts, basically every town does their own. So on the left are the elements that we dealt with in the 2010 plan, and then the FEMA has added additional layers as the planning process has matured. So now we're into being brought into in red, the drought, and working your way up into climate change. I attended a conference the other day, FEMA's going in finally with both feet on climate change, which is just encouraging because earlier versions of the plan didn't really deal with that. So we coordinate, obviously, locally with a local hazard mitigation team, folks that I outlined, their staff. We do reach out as much as possible to engage folks who are interested, residents and businesses, institutions, community organizations, watershed folks. We have two public meetings during the plan development, and then typically what happens, we'll send the draft up to MEMA, and they send it up to FEMA for assessment, and the comments come back to us, we make the changes, and then it comes back to the board for approval, and then finally back up for approval to MEMA and FEMA. So steps in the plan themselves, we take a look at identifying critical infrastructure, that in a minute, assessing risks and vulnerabilities, current and carried forward in the update, looking at existing mitigation, everything from zoning to street sweeping practices, tree trimming, could be at this point installation of micro grids. It's getting to be a wider range. And then we obviously look at prioritizing strategies. We get into the approval process, and then we're here at step six in terms of updating former plan. So critical infrastructure, sorry for the map, but it's the way they scale down. 130 sites. It's really what the community identifies in terms of CI, can be fire and police, elderly housing, daycare centers. Typically will include all your water infrastructure, could be radio towers. It's really up to the town to decide, but again, it makes a nice reference point, sort of put it all in one place. And we include this as a spreadsheet as well as on. We have a map series that goes with the actual plan itself. Part of our work is to do hazard identification and mapping, so we go back through the state and federal databases to look at historical instances of snowfall, wind speeds, hurricanes, earthquake risk. Typically, we'll do that on a county basis and see, you know, what's happened over the last time period varies, but we'll go back quite a ways, and we'll compare what you've got to the state hazard mitigation plan, and again, continue to bounce this off the local team to get information. Really, the most valuable part would be gun is to just sit down and talk with people about what floods where, what's been hit by lightning, you know, what gets swept away in the last heavy windstorm, that type of thing. So existing mitigation measures, do a review on that, comprehensive emergency management plan, which is really more of a response plan rather than a planning, that's sort of a fire and emergency management hang on to that. Fortunately, in Massachusetts, we have a fairly progressive state building code. We tend to take it for granted, but believe it or not, there's parts of the country where there's a variance. There isn't necessarily a state building code. There's counties and actually even local building codes, which makes it pretty interesting. And of course, you've got your multi-department review of developments. Flood-related hazards, although probably not as big a deal here as in some places where you've got coastal issues. People enrolled in the National Flood Insurance Program, but infrastructure improvements, again, primarily identified what you guys have got mostly is a big study that was done a few years ago by ACOM, the town's consultant on what needs to be fixed. Regulation of development in the floodplain protection districts, and then your basic sort of housekeeping measures like street sweeping. Wind, same kind of deal, and then in addition to that, town and utility trimming programs, keeping your corridors clear, and then of course the electrical utility will do their own sort of corridor trimming programs every 3 to 4 years, and winter-related hazards, and then brush fire-related hazards, permits, subdivision review. So we put all that together, we look for where the gaps are, what's been done, what can further reduce vulnerability, and really what are the priorities coming forward in the update. So this is some of the work that has been done since 2010, some work over at Morgan Park for drainage improvements. And again, we did, in the last iteration, I worked with Wilmington, very similar work, a lot of drainage channel clearing, dredging of brooks and cleaning the brooks. It's amazing how much difference that makes, but it's only really been in the last decade or so where people have started to do that sort of actively, because it's become more of an issue as we get heavier precipitation, although maybe not as frequent rain, but when we get rain now with climate change, we get hammered. If you pile up 3 inches of rain and it's got nowhere to go, get immediate effects. So people have started to do, I think, a better job of keeping their drainage systems cleared out. So West Street, drainage lines replaced there, milepost and haystack. We've had a new detention pond at Calarezos and back since 2011.
and at Oak Ridge and Cherry Lane Drive, again, drain line cleaning and replacement of Pennsylvania Avenue has relieved, it's given the water a place to go. And places like North Reading, Wilmington, it's tough because there isn't that much relief to topographically. And when you do release water, you're often just releasing it to either your neighbor or the next town down. And it's, as you guys, I'm sure you deal with on a very consistent basis in planning, this is, it's tough. And, you know, how to make that water, let it get into the ground or get it out without damaging your neighbor or your downstream neighbors or your next town over. So this is the updating process. This is what we're doing again, critical infrastructure. We're working with a team to look at locally identified hazard areas. Julie's looking at potential development areas, what's been built recently, and what the town is projecting may be built over the next few years. Projects that you've got in the pipeline, either conceptually or that have been permitted or been recently permitted. That gives us a better handle on what may become additional impervious area, which is, you know, adding again, depending on how it's regulated, adding to runoff or not. And then updating existing mitigation measures, any bylaws. I know that the town, I think, is contemplating a change to their stormwater bylaw. And then looking at the status of mitigation from previous plans, very important to FEMA. When you list out these projects, even though these plans aren't particularly binding, they're pretty sticky in the process with us in terms of finding, you know, really getting into the details of what's been done and what's being carried forward. I should emphasize that these plans, even though the town signs off on them, are not technically binding. No one's going to come back at you and say, oh, you listed this project, why isn't it done? This is really just sort of a cataloging. The adoption of the plan by the town is really an acknowledgement process rather than sort of a binding commitment. So, and then we get into recommendations for mitigation based on what the team is seeing and what people in town tell us. And again, this is sort of a whited out area. We tried to show the flood zones on this, which is why this is, looks a little strange, because people tend to focus on the areas prone to flooding. But the purpose here is we ask people who do come in, or members of the board, to comment on, you know, what are we missing in terms of where it floods, brush fire. The chief has outlined several areas added to what we knew from 2010 are the areas that he feels are at risk. What have you seen from winter storms and hurricanes, geologic hazards, anything you might have noticed? We collected a lot of information. Was it Wilmington? It's Burlington. They had a ton of information on extreme thunderstorms that had struck because they lost a lot of trees. So people had to go out and take these trees down, but they cataloged all of it. So we were able to gather some, you know, pretty good information about how many people lost power and for how long and how many trees were lost. And they actually wound up adding additional money to their tree trimming program because they were losing a lot of trees in these high wind events that seem to be more common these days. And then mitigation measures and just sort of questions about the process. We'll return to this in a minute. We'll just sort of finish off this quick show here. So again, what's next with this plan? Once we pull the draft together and we're happy with it, coming probably later this year, we'll go in front of the Board of Selectmen, review the plan, and then send it off to MEMA for their review. If they like it, they have changes, comments, we make those changes, send it back to MEMA. They look at it, okay it, and then it's then sent on to FEMA, and the plan, again, will come back to us for additional comments. And we put final adoption of the plan once that has been all through the loop. And the day that it's adopted by the Board of Selectmen, you're good to go for another 5 years. So that's where I am. I have cards. If you would like my card, you're welcome to take one. If you want to think about this or speak with colleagues, check out areas that you may know or not certain. And also have a map with me, if you care to step forward and mark up areas, take a look at it, or I can leave it with the town, we can mark it up at your convenience and I can pick it up, so that's what I have.
Thank you.
Sure. Any questions or comments?
I'm curious, the, one of the things that I didn't hear mentioned much was transportation. And because one of the things about managing the emergency is being able to get in and out of where there is one.
Yeah.
We're, because of the highways, we've got restricted transport in several different directions. And you know, we've got probably some facilities that you can get to anytime, to hospitals and so forth. And some of them that you couldn't get to on a hope,
yeah,
if the, you know, lost a bridge on 128, for example. I was wondering how much that factors into the recognition and planning, if at all.
Well, it actually comes up quite a bit, because when we talk with this, our sort of frame of reference is really natural hazards. That's sort of where FEMA frames this for us. That's our context.
Mm-hmm.
But most of the work, I would say the majority of it, really deals with moving people around the town more easily. And again, roads that flood, neighborhoods that you can't get out of. So indirectly, it's referenced quite a bit. But no, it does not. We wouldn't address like artery traffic jams or peak hour periods,
yeah,
that kind of thing.
I was thinking more of the, you know, if a hurricane came in and dropped trees across Main Street.
Yep.
You know, that makes a very, very real practical difference.
Well, that's an excellent point. And again, I will say that people are adding additional capacity for just that kind of emergency, because they have had a lot of additional flash flooding. People are adding pumps. They're adding basically manpower in order to run,
mm-hmm,
those pumps. And they're adding additional crew capacity, working more closely with utility folks, so that when these hit, they have a plan to go out. And almost everybody is really, over the last 5 to 7 years, now has a full-time emergency management director that is totally spot on for what you're talking about. And that's what,
okay,
they do. They coordinate with the fire and DPW folks. They, you know, typically when they know you're going to get like a hurricane or 3 or 4 inches of rain, there's usually a release program for water, either in dams or reservoirs, that's released, so you have additional flood storage capacity.
Mm-hmm.
It's a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes. They line people up so when the trees do go down, you've got a whole bunch of guys with chainsaws getting ready to go out,
yeah,
there and clear it out. So, yeah, it has had an impact. It's a little hard to see it. But there's been a lot of added, I think, capacity in all the towns. That great expense, I might add, over the last 10 or 15 years. Because,
right,
this is sort of new stuff. And
well, the recognition of it, yeah.
Yeah, the recognition of it. But the storms have been, they've really been with us now for like 20 years. And people have figured it out. They're going to keep coming, unfortunately. So.
Is there, you hit the nail on the head with what I was thinking about, that this is all natural,
all natural
hazards.
Yep.
And there's, I'm going to say, a whole lot more man-made hazards that we deal with on a regular basis that emergency management folks would need to deal with. Is there something either state, regional-wide that gets down at the local level of all of those, you know, all of those man-made hazards? I'm thinking, you know, like what happened here, when was that? Two decades ago, maybe a decade and a half, with the truck in an accident spilling whatever it was near our wells.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there is a state hazardous response unit.
So there's a plan, perfect planning guffaw right there.
Yeah.
Where we had no plan in place. We've got a highway,
yeah,
right. Stone's, mm-hmm, throw away from our drinking water supply.
Yeah.
You know, really not really thought out well to respond to that. That's the kind of thing,
yeah,
you know, is there, and it's obviously not this process, but I was just wondering, if there's other.
You may find it interesting, it's another one of those things that people don't spend a lot of time looking at, but if you talk to your emergency management director, your community emergency management plan, the SEMP plan, should have that in there, and that's required to be updated yearly. That's mm-hmm. a serious plan. That's the one people actually really pay attention to.
For sure, now it does, because the tanker did.
Crash.
Well,
that's right. Right. Everybody gets complacent when things don't happen.
Right.
And of course, everybody, you know, we're all human, right? So, and the resources flow to stuff that happens, but. You are required, and that's a relatively new deal too. The SEMP plans, well, I don't think they were around 15 years ago. That's a new that's a new deal. There's a lot more resources around for hazardous response than there ever have been since I've been working in this business. So really, even though it sounds like we're in like a lot worse shape, we're really actually in a lot better shape. Nobody comes to these meetings to talk about these plans because everybody's doing something else on a nice June night. But the fact that they're happening and staff is engaged and people put time into these things, there's a lot of good stuff that happens. There is. I mean, the town has done a ton of work studying what they need to be doing and what they're going to be moving forward with. So you're in a lot better shape than some smaller communities and some of the larger communities that are 90% paved and looking to put stormwater any which way they can.
Do any of these grants help offset some of the costs that come up from the SEMP plans if they identify some infrastructure piece that's not up to date? I just keep thinking about fire. So let's say fire identifies some sort of hazard somewhere, but they don't really have the apparatus to get to it.
Yep.
Do these grants help offset the costs of adding that kind of infrastructure?
They typically won't add equipment, so it's usually infrastructure related. If you do add, it can be equipment as long as it's specifically targeted at natural hazard emergency response. So if you had, say, a part of a building, like an emergency facilities building or part of your safety building, and you wanted to add on to that, because we've had a lot of people say, oh, that's great, you know, we're building a new DPW facility, can we apply for, you know, $2 million to help offset that? No, but you can apply for the part that is actually specifically dedicated to emergency hazard response for natural hazard response.
So backup generators?
Yes, backup generators, definitely. They sometimes consider like emergency radio equipment, but they've told that they basically have discouraged us on equipment related stuff. They really want people to think about, they're very, very keen on planning, on changing your rules and prevention, which is normal. Mm-hmm. And they don't want things at the end of the pipe anymore. They really want to see, you know, for instance, water staying where it falls rather than running off is typical for them.
What about, say, purchasing a piece of land that could be turned into some sort of detention?
You know, that's a really good question, and I don't know if anybody's been funded for land purchase. I've never heard of that happening. I mean, 95% of the projects that I know of are, you know, culverts or drain pipes or seawalls, some type of protection and adding existing. But land purchase, it's a good question because we do an inventory of land, which is, of course, your best protection against flooding is maintaining open space.
Well, one of the other things is that sometimes what you want to do is purchase an easement.
Yes.
To constrain the land use or, you know, constrain the development.
I'll check into that. I'll find out. That'd be an interesting to know if anybody's actually been successful in either having an easement granted or purchasing an easement.
Right.
An easement. That'd be good to know. I'll ask the state, see what's happening with the easement. Maybe we'll know.
Good.
So I should mention that when we get all done with this, before we start our process with MEMA and sending it into them, this will be posted online. The draft will be online for 10 days. If you want to take a look and make any comments or have any questions, it'll be on the town website.
Mm-hmm.
And these guys will let you know. So. Good.
Excellent.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thanks. Switch because we had to reschedule everything from last time. We had to re-advertise.
Okay.
So he was nice enough to switch. He was supposed to be on the 20th.
Okay.
But yeah, so we just.
What are you doing on the 20th? You told me.
Two hearings that we were supposed to do in May.
Yeah.
Oh,
have
yeah.
You all been real busy? A lot going on?
Yeah, and more is coming. A lot more is coming.
Is
so.
It mostly residential or commercial?
Yeah, we got a couple of 40Bs, the residential.
40Bs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't look at those
commercial.
Hazards, right?
Say
you don't consider those hazards?
I'm not touching that one.
Yeah.
I've been
anyway,
on,
we have
I've
some
been on both sides of that. I've been on both sides of that. Anyway, good luck, and thanks again for your time.
You know where I was going with that land purchase issue is if that was a real thing, that might help sway people into a CPA, which is
right.
Partially funded by this grant. You start buying up land, not only for protecting things, but you start buying up land and you start controlling these open spaces.
We did a ton of that when I worked up in the city of PV. I don't know how many acres we preserved with the CPA, 35, 40 acres.
What people here don't understand is I think that's how towns like Concord and those places are protecting themselves against these 40Bs, right? If you own the land, you can develop it any way you want or not develop it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Or if it's in private ownership of any kind, whether it's a golf club or something else, I mean, it's...
30% of Concord is preserved.
Yeah. And I know Winchester, many years ago, controlled that large piece of land and developed that the way they wanted
mm-hmm.
to. That farm.
Weiss Farm.
Yeah.
Is that Weiss?
It sounds
right.
Yeah.
Right Lock Farm.
Right Lock, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, West Farm is the one in Waltham,
mm-hmm.
I think.
Weiss is the one in Burlington.
Weiss is Burlington? Stone?
No, in Wilbur, right.
There's no question, you know, I've brought up the Community Preservation Act many, many times over the last 7 years, and I've always not had any kind of positive response. So.
More money.
We've never been assaulted by the 40Bs like we have been lately.
We have to get through the override first.
Yeah, I think the override's gonna give us a good idea of what folks have an appetite for in terms of any kind of increase in taxes. You know, if it sails through, then that'll tell us one thing. If it's close, that'll tell us something. And if it's defeated, that'll really tell us something.
Okay, let's see. Potential zoning bylaw amendments.
The last time we talked about signs, Ray was here. And then this time I prepared some like second drafts of site plan review and minor amendments based on feedback I got from you guys. So I don't know if you had a chance to look at them or not, but there's nothing majorly different than last time, and mostly I just incorporated the feedback you gave. I guess it must have been the first meeting in May. And then I got a couple emails from some of you with additional comments.
So if we look at the site plan review one,
mm-hmm.
I looked at that and I thought you had a comment there that said, how do we define in-kind replacement?
Yeah, that was something that was brought up last time. I forget who brought that up, but we just had a placeholder for like thinking about it in more depth.
I collected a whole bunch of definitions for those sort of terms from
okay.
the building code,
mm-hmm.
from different building codes and some zoning codes too. There are some definitions in there that say things like routine maintenance, repairs, in-kind replacement, where you're not changing the extent of the element. There's also discussion where, in the building code specifically, if you have the effect of replacing the entire system, then you're usually required to bring it up to code.
Right.
So if you're replacing 90% of the electrical system in a building, you're going to bring that all up to code, as opposed to just the piece that you're doing. So I thought that in-kind replacement sounded intuitive enough where we didn't need a definition, another definition.
Yeah.
I'm good with that, because I do think it sounds, I mean, we can't define everything.
No.
I think it's fairly
well,
intuitive.
The only...
I can't imagine how we, at this point, how we get a, how that gets twisted in a way where it doesn't, you know, someone tries to use that to skirt around the rules in such a way that it's going to make a big difference.
Right. I agree.
The only risky portion of it, perhaps, is lighting. Because if you change the technology, you know, it's, you know, yes, it's still a light, it's still a wall pack, but if you go from high pressure sodium to an LED, then there's a dramatic difference in the luminance and the color. So and
in the color, but you would strive for the same number of lumens.
You would strive for the same number
of brightness, the same lighting levels.
Except that's not what's happening with the streetlights. I mean, I agree with you.
You mean the actual right-of-way streetlights? Street streetlights?
Do you mean the ones that they're replacing with LEDs?
Right.
Are you noticing it in a negative way, though?
They're a lot brighter.
Right.
Oh, I noticed the exact opposite. It's bright up there, but it doesn't shed as much light. That's what I saw. When you look at it, it looks brighter, but when you look at what it's what they're actually lighting up, they leave.
You're thinking about the one at the bottom of Heather now.
Well, they're all the way up Heather now.
Yeah, if you look at the bottom, the beam spread's not nearly as wide.
Yeah.
So what they do with the LEDs now with those Cobra head type is that the lenses are very refined. So they make prisms on that lens to get that light to go exactly where they want to, so they don't have to have 5,000 LEDs in there, you know, so they can pretty much control it.
Yeah.
As I say, I mean, it's not a big thing, but I mean, that's the only thing where the, in-kind replacement might have some variation.
I mean, if we had requirements that all lighting, you know, needs to be fully cut off and downward facing and dark sky friendly, you might not notice as many negative impacts if someone changes technology.
Mm-hmm. We still say zero light off the property line, right?
Well, but that's if they're pushed into site plan review. If the in-kind replacement means that they're exempt from the site plan review.
I think part of this is the reality is if someone's going to change out some light fixtures, they're not coming in and talking to anyone, right? I mean,
they get electrical permit probably.
That's all.
Yeah,
if it's new, they don't already have electricity.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, if they're taking one off the wall and put another one on that happens to be LED.
But I can tell you what's happening. They're going in the electrical supply.
Yeah.
I mean, logical.
Yeah.
Hey, look, it's on Mass Save this week.
Right.
50 of these.
Yeah.
Watch them go up.
Yeah.
10 times brighter than what you had.
No, as I say, I mean, it's not a not a big thing. I'm not sure, you know, pretty sure that we don't want to try and word ourselves around it. But it's
yeah.
A lot of big projects or redevelopments that come through site plan review for other triggers will look at lighting as part of the whole package. So.
Yep.
You could put a percentage. They increase the lighting by more than 10% on the site or something, or
well, basically in kind means equivalent, you know, and then that's a close enough definition, I
and
think.
Then we pick it up in the next section, when we talk about 4.6.2.3 in C, it's mentioned that if an existing site becomes a nuisance, including illumination beyond the hours of operation.
Yep. Never mind.
I think if something were to go up that was particularly bothersome.
Mm-hmm.
And
I mean, if it's really bothersome, we'll hear about it from a neighbor. I mean, we'll try to work with the owner.
And the other comment or question here is about is whether 300 square feet of pavement is too low. But that's about the smallest you could make two parking spaces, and we're talking about two parking spaces.
Yeah, it is. It's probably a little bit smaller than the total of two parking spaces.
Yeah, like 2 9x18s is about as small as you'd ever go. They're usually 10x20, right? So it's between 300 and 400, so I think the number's okay. Since everything above it talks about two spaces.
In some places of town, that seems small, but in others, that would be a lot.
Mm. Exactly.
So I think we
err like
on the smaller side.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll just put it out there. I like on that the one we just talked about, C6.4.6.2.3C. I like that as a way to deal with some things that come up after the fact. I'm interested in how that, whether how town council views that, and how that might work in real life.
Yeah.
If someone's digging their heels in. So, but it's worth a shot.
I think it is, because right now it kind of falls between the cracks.
Yeah.
I put it under minor, so they don't have to do the full blown.
Yeah.
And we can just target like what the specific issue is.
What the specific issue is.
Yeah.
Yeah. That will be interesting to see what town council says about that.
But
it's in for now.
Yeah. No, I think that's.
That was all I had under that one. Is anybody else have comments on site plan review?
No, I think it looks good.
Okay. minor edits, huh? What's that? I mean,
it's just minor.
Oh.
Yeah.
So accessory buildings. 5.5.
So these are like similar to the other one, changes we talked about, and then some changes that were sent to me. And I put the initials, like, if you look at comment one, it says NS. That was like a paraphrasing of the comment that you sent me.
Yeah. Any pool-related building, my comment was basically, well, you know, you put the pump or the heater in a small little room, maybe have a bathroom, and then you have this gigantic garage next to it.
That's the way that it's listed here is, there is no, it can be any size.
We have this exception. Let's see what happens. Why is it bad to let this sort of go unregulated?
Why is it bad to what?
Why would it be bad? I shouldn't have said it that way. Why would it be bad to leave this the way it's written and not worry about how big this pool facility is?
The way that it's written right now, you can't install, I mean, in the existing zoning, we need to do something because the way it's written, you can't install a sort of a normal size standard size pool.
I actually think that maybe we should take out any related buildings.
But I do think if you take out any related buildings,
yeah.
then any building just becomes a standard accessory.
Because the issue we're having is with the actual pool itself, not the pool building.
Mm.
It's like people can't put in a standard size pool because it's larger than what our accessory structure bylaw allows. But the pool building would be regulated just as a regular
structure.
Accessory.
So it would
yeah.
read
yep.
a swimming pool and or equipment? Or should it say a swimming pool and then nothing else?
Could just say a swimming pool, a tennis court, or similar home recreational facility.
Right. So the setbacks have to be maintained. So that protects the neighbors. And lot coverage is still there. And the building would be under accessory structure.
I think that works.
I don't think that many people build big pool houses around here in the smaller lots anyways.
Yeah.
Well, they can't now anyway. They couldn't build something enormous because they're limited by the current bylaw
right,
and the lot
right.
coverage.
But realistically, if they've only got so much yard,
yeah.
When I get the pool in, you know, they're not so concerned about having the big giant cabana because they just don't have enough room. Whereas if you start moving up to the 2 acres lots, you'll
right.
get that more often.
So I'll take out that one.
So what's our suggested change here?
To delete and any pool-related buildings or equipment. So that it reads a swimming pool, comma, tennis court, or similar home recreation facility.
Yep. I mean, the other thing would you could strike out the pool buildings and leave in the any related pool equipment. But just strike out the buildings.
But the
eliminating the whole phrase also works.
The equipment
that's you know
yeah. I'm not sure what I mean the equipment ends up being even if it's not in a structure, which typically it's, you know, with your structure with your shed, your little pool house, or it's just in a little, you know,
or
shed
I mean,
itself.
If it's the I've forgotten what the hell they're called, basically the pool with the above ground pool,
yeah,
with a pad mounted pump
yeah.
filter, you know. But the thing is that we don't have to specify, we don't have to be that specific. Just say a swimming pool. I think covers
I
it.
I think that's good enough.
I think so
yeah.
too.
And my neighbor up the street has exactly that.
Yeah.
You know the.
Just scroll down to the next section.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I haven't asked Glenn about that temporary storage unit question.
Do you have to get a permit for that? That's for buildings. For a temporary storage unit?
I don't think they're allowed now.
It's a special permit.
I would hope so. You're right, you need to get a permit for a dumpster. Isn't it the same?
It's supposed to get a permit for
Well, yeah. Isn't it the same thing? Except it has a top? Sort of.
Well, if you get the
it's a
the
big the metal thing in your yard.
If you get the dumpster in a bag, does that require a permit?
I don't think so.
No.
Hmm.
Why do we want someone to come in for a special permit in a residential district?
I was just asking if we did.
Well, this is, I don't think that I added this, I think this was existing.
Well, let's see.
But I don't know that it makes sense really.
We're talking about 90 days too.
Like someone should need a special permit for a temporary storage unit, I wouldn't think.
Well, the existing bylaw, it's 551J is the temporary storage unit clause.
Yeah, we do require it now.
But it's through the CPDC.
Right.
Right.
And say this is too. I just I reworded it to make it more clear, but it's the same requirement.
So when people are getting those store to door or door to, no, what is it called? Door to door, the pods.
Pods, yep.
Yeah. And they sit in their yard for a couple of days as they pack them up. Are they really supposed to go get a permit for those?
Well, I think the problem is if you're doing an addition and you pull all the furniture out of your house,
and then
that's gonna sit in that driveway for 6 months.
Yeah.
You could.
No, so we have this 90-day clause, which is good.
But it's not really a clause, it's really just,
so special permit.
So any period, not to exceed 90 days. I mean, it says,
so
2 days, then yeah, you're supposed to get a special
permit.
That's for residences, by the way. The other ones, we don't have that.
Right.
Right, so in any district, you can get one of these, just like they have behind OAs and stuff, right?
Yeah, but so these are permanent in any district. That the first section A, those are all like permanent things.
Okay, well, you definitely want to permit those.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, then, do we want to have a minimum and a maximum?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. The
more than
14 and less than 80 or 90, whatever it is.
You guys decide. What do you think's reasonable?
I think it should be 7. You should be able to pack that thing in under a week.
Well, we're thinking about construction.
Right.
So construction is probably the worst thing. You're doing a major renovation in your house.
And you're relying on contractors and yeah.
Yeah, well, actually, I mean, the contractor might bring a couple of those in to do their work as your tools, right?
And the contractor really should get the permit.
Well,
CVS,
I mean,
Rite Aid is doing that, I think.
Yes.
For example, something like the temporary storage units, which will be present for more than 15 days, will require a special permit. Something
I'll
like
that. I'll tell you what, one situation, you can think about it. I guess it's still South Street, you know, where it turns on Walnut Street. There's
right.
The guy who wanted to do the accessory apartment or the in-law apartment there and building the big addition there. The contractor was parking his dumpsters and his trailers right on the root ball of that tree that everyone argued about saving. Right? So he staged his construction right on top of the root ball of that tree. And the whole issue with that lot was that tree.
The whole thing.
So, you know, protecting something like that, maybe it's a good idea that they come in. You know, you're not blocking your neighbor's sight line to a really busy street. You're not on top of some major utility that they don't seem to know about. So long term,
right.
And commercial, I think it's definitely got to be in there. Residential. I guess I don't know what the minimum rental period is on those things.
I mean, I think if it's,
I
if it's to me,
contact.
Just it feels like if it's under a week, it sort of seems like more process than needs to happen. I don't know, maybe it's 2 weeks, maybe it's 1 week, but if it goes on for more than 2 weeks, it sort of feels, I think it probably starts to feel like
right.
It's been there a long time. So,
you know, that's why I would suggest 15 days is a reasonable, you know, window, you know, if you can get it there and, you know, get it put there and have it for a week and then get it taken away. I mean,
gives you 2 weekends.
Right.
Right.
I just think that people aren't going to know, and then by the if a neighbor calls and complains about it, and then we try to drag them through a process, the pot's going to be gone before the process has even really begun. Just because you guys meet every, you know, twice
yeah.
a month, and there's stuff involved in these things, and if it's a special permit, then there's, I guess we would have to decide if we wanted to advertise. I mean, I don't know.
A lot of complaints about him?
All
any complaints about this?
We do. Well, because people, they take advantage, you know, they just leave these things there forever. That's the problem.
That's, yeah.
I mean, nobody cares if you're doing a construction project and something's in the driveway for a short time. It's, for whatever reason, and I don't know what the reason would be, they just end up staying there for way too long. And that's when we get the complaints.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I guess that.
Well, so if that's, I guess that's the thing. If it's 15 days, and the complaint comes in, say it comes in day, you know, 7 or 8, you can say, man, they can keep it there for 15. You know they're going to call back at day 15. Then the process happens, starts to happen, coming by day 30, they're either, or maybe 40, they're either in here or they've shipped it out. So sort of, you know, there's, you're right, there's a,
elasticity, whatever.
I think maybe what we do is we take the special permit process out of this. We say that they're allowed and they need to meet setbacks for a certain period of time. Once, if they're not meeting setbacks or that they exceed the time and we get calls from neighbors, we do zoning enforcement. Versus like having people
right.
come through us. Because we can, if it's in the bylaw that it needs to meet setbacks and there's a limited period of time, we can enforce that if we get a complaint.
But that means that they can never, no one can ever put one on there for longer than that period.
Well, yeah, I mean, I guess we would have to decide
yeah.
what a reasonable period of time is. Or maybe just say they're allowed as long as they meet. We don't want them staying forever.
Hmm. Well, the thing is, if they meet setbacks, then it's just, it's a temporary, you know, it's a accessory structure, right? Yeah.
Could be tied to like a building permit or something?
No, only if they have one.
Yeah, if they came in for a building permit, I guess that could be a question that's on the building permit. Will you be placing a temporary, you know, storage unit on the property during construction?
Well, that's what we talked about with Rite Aid. They came right in and said, look, we don't have any place to put anything. We need these temporary storage units.
Mm.
We talked about that, and you know, my opinion was they have so much excessive parking at that Rite Aid.
Right.
It wasn't going to hurt anything. It's not in a residential area. You know, they're only going to be in there for a short time. So it's like that test of reasonableness.
Yeah.
I don't know how you codify that, but
I think the commercial ones will almost always catch.
Yeah.
The residential ones, we don't want to make it a burden. We also don't want to.
Could it be at the call of the building? I hate to keep putting it on the building inspector, but that's the person that's going to hear about it first, probably,
right.
without making it an onerous process. If it's a reasonable, in the opinion of the building inspector, and if it's excessive, then it goes to some level of zoning enforcement.
Mm-hmm. Well, is there a reasonable way to word it?
I mean, building inspectors making judgment calls on much bigger things than storage containers.
But I mean, for example, you could add the paragraph or reword the paragraph to say that in residence districts, temporary storage units that are required for a period more than 15 days require a permit, review and permit by the building inspector.
Should we run this by his office before we attempt to dump yet another task on him?
I think he really should be intervening when there's an issue, not just like every time someone needs it for like 3 weeks instead of 2 weeks.
Mm.
I just think about all the minutiae he's already dealing with.
I know.
It's like
I like that idea that it's just anything in excess of 15 days. If it's not an issue, no, right? If it's not an issue, it's not going to be an issue.
Right.
It's no one's going to bring it up. It's all good. If it's an issue and it's been there for more than 15 days, that's when it's going to. And if it comes for a special permit, that's when we decide whether that's where we put the time limit on it. Yeah, you can have it there in perpetuity, or you can have it there for, you know, in for the end of the season, and make that time period part of this, you know, it's part of the special permit. But anything over 15 days needs to come in for a special permit. Is that?
That seems reasonable.
And not worry about the max, because
right.
we can take that on a case by case basis.
Mm-hmm.
It's the beauty of special permits.
So 15 days then, or are we looking at 3 weeks? Is 3 weeks reasonable?
20 days? I mean, pick a number.
21?
30? I don't know, I just. When do we start counting? When we first hear about it?
Well, what we want them to do
is. No homeowner is going to know to come in. Unless they also are doing some other big project and they're going through the permit process anyway.
Yeah, I mean, but that's the time that we want to arm our building inspector, so that if it's obvious that they're going to have it there for a period more than N days, then they've got a chance to go ahead and get the permit, you know, up front. I mean, without delaying the work. You know, if they can come in and you know, they can tell that it's going to be there for a week and a half and then gone, that's cool. You know, if they know that they're taking down half their house and replacing it, they know that it's going to have to be there for more than 15 days, and they'll get the permit as part of the process. I mean, that's what we want to achieve.
Right. I don't think that the permitting process should be longer than the time. I think maybe like 30 days might be better, because then that accounts for the fact that you only meet twice a month. Some months you only meet once if there's like a town meeting. You know what I mean? We don't want to have them coming in and it's like they're going to take it down the next day.
Right.
It's got to be.
I guess I'd be okay with 30 days.
Yeah.
So we're going to delete this not to exceed and just have a minimum? Is that what we're talking about here?
Yeah.
Yep.
In residential districts, provided all front, side, and rear yard setbacks are met, a temporary storage unit.
For more than 30 days.
Well, this paragraph is about getting a special permit, right? Temporary storage units that will be on the property for more than 30 days. It's something like that. I think that's what we're trying to say. In residential districts or in residence districts, a temporary storage unit. for more than 30 days. In
well,
residence districts, the CPDs that may allow a temporary storage unit for more than 30 days, provided all front, side, and rear setbacks are met.
Mm-hmm.
Does that make sense? That implies that under 40 days you don't need it, or does it?
Well, I mean, the better way to handle that is to have, you know, two phrases saying that in residence district, temporary storage units may be present for a maximum of N days. You know, and then have a separate clause that says if you need to go more than that, then you come for a permit.
So do you need to have that first one be up in like general provisions so that you're calling it out right up front?
Well, this is, but this is in the existing law, it's under permitted accessory buildings or structures, which I guess is the same thing here. So yeah, I guess it would go
in
the
general.
The allowance would go in the
general
provisions.
Yep.
And then the extension, if you will.
If you're beyond that, then you go down to.
I feel
yeah.
like they should be together.
Well, they could be together if we change the heading. If you're just talking about temporary storage units.
Well, okay, but so the but A is not talking about temporary.
No.
So, but yeah, I see what you're saying.
You could create another, you go 1, 2, 3, and this could be 4, and have 3 be just about temporary storage units and group them. That probably would be easier for the reader, have them together.
What are you saying? Sorry.
Just create a whole new number. Devoted to
temporary storage
units. Oh, like one of the
or temporary
not a Roman
temporary
numeral.
Structures.
Yeah,
a number like
a number.
Number 4. Okay.
Yeah, maybe it's number 4. Or
yeah,
yeah, maybe it gets renumbered.
Okay.
Mm, yes.
And do we want to talk about 3A, the requirement that the truck trailer for storage or advertising and the standalone shipping and the steel storage unit in any district is allowed if it gets a special permit? Like, do you guys still want that? I mean,
well, they have to, we can deny a special permit.
Right. Yeah.
I think we still need that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. But so you would allow that, it says in all districts, that's the thing.
So in some case, you know, someone who has a deep lot that wants a storage, this storage container way in the back for some reason.
I mean, right now, like, we don't allow storage of vehicles unless they're on pavement and they're registered. I think maybe you can have one unregistered vehicle in your property. I don't remember it specifically, but this might be in direct contradiction to like another part of the bylaw. Like, if we're going to allow this, we might also have to say, well, then you have to extend your driveway all the way back so that you're storing it on the pavement.
But that would be part of the special permit.
I guess.
Process.
Yeah. Mm. Just thinking it through.
Yeah.
Shape that's edited the way we had discussed, right?
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And lot shape came up recently.
Yes.
So Glenn doesn't, if you have an existing a big existing lot and you don't have to create a subdivision road to subdivide it, like you can just A and R it. He doesn't use this.
Okay.
So he really only uses it for like a subdivision.
Here's the thing. If I am reading this, if I'm going through, I'm trying to figure out everything I do, I need to do, how do I know that?
Right.
It doesn't say that anywhere. It's his interpretation of what this says and when it gets applied. And that's, I think that's the problem. It's not that when he applies or when he doesn't,
right.
There's no indication
it's not clear.
That it's only limited to
so we
specific
should say
conditions.
That.
Subdivision lots. Yeah. Lots that are created through the subdivision process. I don't know.
And is that right?
Right.
Now that we understand what it is that correct?
But what you said that an A&R is not required to meet this criteria? And that doesn't seem...
No, that's not what I said.
No,
okay.
If you've got a lot, if you're just doing an A&R and splitting two lots, then you're going to do something on them. He doesn't check it this way. If you take your lot, though, and you do your subdivision, then he looks at each of them.
Right, like if you don't have enough frontage to subdivide and you need to create a road to get the frontage, and you're creating all these new lots, then he looks at this. So.
With an A&R, you're either creating a buildable lot
or not.
Or creating a several non-buildable lots, which have to be noted as non-buildable lots.
Well, that's the question.
Right.
Is because the way that I understood it, we ask them to put the statement on it, this is not a buildable lot.
Right.
That has, my understanding is that hasn't always happened, and they're not required to do that. So just a plan that says this is not a buildable lot, although recently we've gotten everyone to do that, that's, there may be some plans that come in that look like a lot, that look like a buildable lot, that were done through the A&R process.
Well,
and that's the thing that I think this gets a little bit quirky about.
But through the A&R process, the only reason something is considered not a buildable lot is because it doesn't have enough frontage. It's not about lot shape. It's about frontage. That's the only reason.
Frontage and area.
Area is not even really
no,
part of
the A&R.
No,
it's just
the
frontage.
Yeah.
You're basically just saying this doesn't have to go through subdivision.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what?
You have to be on a qualified way. You have to have adequate frontage and access.
So if the lot were triangular shape, you had the base of the triangle is on the street, and that gives you the frontage.
Even if it doesn't meet this lot shape.
Yeah, it's not an issue.
It's not, they wouldn't have to say not a buildable lot.
Because it would be buildable?
Because if it has the right frontage. Yeah, because really the A&R is only looking at frontage.
And so even if the size of it is tiny, under...
Well, if it's less than 5,000 square feet, that's like
which
another
is,
state.
Which is state level. But if it's 8,000 square feet.
In
an S15, it's still a buildable lot.
If it's 8,000 square feet, what the applicant should do is get a variance or a special permit from the ZBA first, make a note of the reference to that on the plan, that they got the variance so that they don't have enough area for the zoning district. And that's a threshold that's very hard to get. Unless you have, I mean, the thresholds for variance are
right.
Topography, soils, site conditions.
So a lot that's 5 feet deep and 300 feet long.
They would have to get a variance.
They don't
like
meet
if
the
they
setbacks.
Create. Right.
Yeah, you can't get a building on it.
If they create that lot for you guys, they need to get a variance if they want to be able to build on it.
they got a variance, they could get a variance from lot shape anyways.
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a little like, we've had some recent conversations about this with town council, so.
And he's in agreement with removing it as a requirement from non-subdivision lots.
He's in agreement with what? Removing what from requirement?
He is in agreement with removing the lot shape requirement.
No, we haven't talked to him about this.
Oh.
We've talked to him about the A and R process as it relates to variances and undersized lots. And lot shape, but not about like our definition.
Well, if the building inspector has never enforced this for A and R lots, then it's never been an issue.
I don't know if that's true though. I think it's somewhat ambiguous. I think what would be helpful is to have it be clear in the zoning bylaw how this is to be applied and follow that.
Right.
Because I don't think we've been consistent.
Okay.
I think if we clarify it, that would help Glenn.
Yes.
Right, but we can clarify, but what does that mean to us? We don't want it to, we don't care if they apply those to A and R lots. We don't see that that's a problem. Is that what we're saying?
Well, the word, well, it sounds like the, in the case of an A and R, whether or not it's buildable is based on other criteria. So it's access and frontage. And this would be, you know, an unnecessary complication.
So it, doesn't this really just belong in the subdivision control?
Right.
And not in zoning?
Yeah.
If that's where we're
unless, unless this is definitions, it's not. It's, right?
I think we talked about this, whether or not it should be a subdivision. I'm having a deja vu moment.
Yeah. You know, the circle that's used. We're in that full circle.
I think it's here for a reason.
Well, it's probably here because we weren't sure how it was being applied. If we thought it applied to all lots, then it would be here.
Some towns just make a statement like, you can't create a lot with an angle that's, you know, more acute than 60 degrees, or, you know, so you don't end up with like really strange, or like you can't, if the lot gets narrower than 50 feet at any point, you can't develop behind it. So then you don't have someone like making an hourglass shaped lot. You know, I mean, there's
okay,
other ways.
So there's two things here. One is, does it belong here or in the subdivision rules? And two, what are other towns doing?
And I got the list of what every town in the
every
state
town.
Is doing. And some don't care. They don't define it. And some
yeah, they probably have like 10-acre zoning or something where it won't
yeah,
it's matter.
Right. Some use like the diameter, the circle. Your buildable area has to be a certain length,
okay,
depending on the zoning district you're in. Some use the angle, like I mentioned. There's just different ways. I guess it just depends on what the goal is.
Okay, well, I'd like to see those, I guess.
I'll send that again.
All right.
I'll send it to you guys tomorrow.
But I guess, what's our goal here? I mean, not in terms, I mean, the goal here is making this more clear,
mm-hmm.
but in terms of lot shape, what are we really after? Or what are we trying, what's this, what problem is are we trying to solve?
Well,
super irregular lots.
Yeah, pork chop lots.
Yeah, usually I think lot shape really gets at eliminating
pork chop
lots. And then
yeah.
some towns will have like a bylaw that has, if you're in a situation where you can make a pork chop lot with 50 feet, and then you have to have a certain diameter in the back, they'll have a special provision to allow it that you have to meet certain thresholds.
Yeah.
But I don't know how big of a deal it is here.
Well, we just did that very thing almost with the special permit for
the PUD.
The house that just came in, yeah, the PUD. Right, they went PUD. So we've set a precedent with using that as a way of getting that irregular shaped lot.
Should I ask Glenn, like, just what he thinks would be the best way to tackle this?
I'd like to know what he thinks. Because if he comes back and just says, oh, it's a pain, I don't really feel like dealing with it, then that's different than it causes problems for builders who are doing reasonable things.
Well,
In our case, it's really the potential to develop the back half of lots that are probably not even developable. But if someone wanted to, right, there's all those really long and thin lots. Someone could come along and buy, you know, the back half of your lot you're not using and put them all together and do some odd shaped lots in that.
Well,
if they could accumulate.
If they could accumulate, yeah.
Or if they put it in a private way, put it in a private street.
Or some fairly awkward infill lots. But I'm at this point, I'm not sure that I think it's not a massive problem, right? I mean, everything is going to come in, it's going to be sort of odd and unique. That deals with this.
I mean,
whether it's a good thing or not a good thing.
Perhaps the some compromise between this and the, you know, lot frontage, lot and the yard definition. I mean, basically, what you want is if they've got the frontage, you want them to have the required yard at the frontage.
Yeah.
And this, you know, whatever they want to do behind that, you know, more power to them.
Or like the width, lot width has to be maintained at the building line. That's another way to get more regular.
Yeah.
I think that's what Concord does, if I remember correctly.
I like that.
Yeah. And you know, I don't know how to put that into
we'll look at the Concord
zoning
one.
Language. Yeah.
So many of the towns do it totally different.
Totally different,
and
I know.
It's like, it really just depends on what the goal is.
Okay.
And how much land area there still is for, like, development.
Well, what we want to avoid is a street full of driveways.
Yeah.
No visible houses.
I have a question for you before we go. 5.4.7.3b. How did you come up with the 750 square feet?
Wait, say this again.
5.4.7.3.
5.4. Where are we?
So it's back to accessory buildings.
Rented.
Accessory apartments.
I think there is an A, and I just pulled this one out because this is the only part that we're changing. Is that what you're asking? Why it says B?
No, I'm asking how do we come up with 750 square feet.
Oh, sorry, I totally didn't hear you. I don't know, but I asked Glenn if he thinks that's sufficient, and he says that it's no problem at all for someone to get.
The standard in a lot of the towns, in the city of Peabody, we use 750 square feet. I think that's a pretty common standard.
That's a one-bedroom apartment.
Well,
actually, kitchen, dining, living.
I mean, that's a generous one-bedroom apartment.
Yeah, it's a good size.
Well, I mean, 720 square feet is the standard two-bedroom, one-bath Cape. That's the dimension of the house.
So I'm thinking an accessory apartment, say, for my father-in-law, who's missing a leg, is in a wheelchair, and can't care for himself.
Yeah.
It's a damn small apartment for a guy with a lot of equipment.
$750? I had
What exactly the reason I built something like that?
Yeah, I mean, I had a 2-bedroom condo that was $950.
My closet's 750 square feet.
There's a unit in my building that's just on the market. It's 480. It's a 1-bedroom.
Yeah. That's Cambridge, right? You'll find millions of those.
It's Arlington, but yeah, same difference.
No, I'm saying in Cambridge you'll find millions of those. And this is an accessory apartment now, remember that.
I know.
So this is allowing something in addition to what's allowed in a single family. So 750 is a good size.
Okay.
I'll
revisit that with Glenn, see if he thinks it might be better to make it.
Yeah, I don't mean building him a house.
The problem when you get larger, and we had a lot of discussion about this when we did the rewrite in 2014, people had real concerns that you were now changing the character of neighborhoods by having accessory living areas that were, in some cases, the same size as the house, or getting close to the same size as the house. And so that's where it starts to get challenging.
That's true. And actually, that's part of the reason why Glenn wanted us to go to take out net floor area and change it to gross, because net eliminates so many parts.
Yeah.
That people were just building things that were way bigger than 750 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And if it's common area, it obviously doesn't get counted in this. So that's the other way. If the space issue, if there's a way to configure it so that a closet is more of a common area or whatever, it's not part of the accessory unit, if you have a special extenuating circumstance, that'd be something that I'm sure we could entertain.
Like that would only work in the ones that are attached.
Right.
Right.
By the time you get that building, you're just building a flat.
Okay, where are we at?
I think that's all of them, right?
There's animal kennel, the whole.
Home occupation,
and
special
home
occupation.
Yeah, so.
These are your question marks here for listing all of these. Pet grooming.
Yes, I was just throwing ideas out there when I put them in.
And you have contractors' yards as a special home occupation. Catering can be done by one non-resident?
Well, basically resident plus a helper is what the presumption that residents plus, one plus one employee.
But Jean probably does it all the time. She is that one employee.
I'm not sure about these contractors' yards yet, so I'm just not sure what they're doing there. And I wouldn't want one next door.
Well, the circumstances is basically
cold.
Yeah.
Whatever we want to call it, a specialist with one helper who needs. Who has a shed with his equipment and his truck? And that's under our definitions that is called a contractor's yard.
I don't think we actually have a definition for it. I'm not sure.
I don't recall adding one just yet.
But this was a specific request we had, because it's not really addressed in the bylaw anywhere, and so like, right now something like Dave describes would not be allowed. But so if we have a special permit process for it, then we can put conditions on certain things like screening and noise and hours and all those things that would protect the abutters.
Yeah, as long as we come up with some good controls on that, because again, you know, I wouldn't want stacks of open materials and spoils and things like that left out.
Right, we would have to require, you know, that they meet certain setbacks and all that
mm-hmm.
stuff. This could potentially be a way to allow for that thing that's happening on Hopkins
mm-hmm.
Street. That we had to enforce.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what did happen on Hopkins Street? They cleared that front of that, the MWRA, did the MWRA use that for
briefly, the
storage?
The
they paid the owner for it?
Briefly.
Okay.
And we shut that down. But it was like right up against and over the property line into the neighbor's yard.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You saw it, it sounds like.
Yeah, I figured he was renting out the front of his yard.
He was, and
okay.
that's not allowed.
I hope his grass doesn't come in.
I mean, but the neighbor was suffering.
Yeah.
His asthma. I mean, it was every possible problem. They were storing big pipes.
All the pipes.
And
yeah.
one of them rolled and just missed his house because it hit a tree. Just rolled right downhill.
Yeah, I was being asked by that by people, and I said, but I don't think it's town property. I looked on the GIS and it's private. And I just figured the MWRA needed more space, and they rented space from the guy.
Mm. It was the contracting company that the MWRA hired that
yeah.
did it.
They don't always check. And
no.
Hard to believe.
They don't ever harass.
Really?
The MWRA only harasses consultants.
But the same company had been told no on a different property
yeah.
in town, so they should have known better.
Can we
they
find them?
Know better.
Yeah, that's what Glenn issued a letter and made a call. And
no, can we fine them? Can we actually collect the fine?
That's part of the letter.
Okay.
Is that if they don't vacate that within a certain amount of time, like a complete cease and desist, then we can fine them every day.
It's empty now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They removed it as soon as they got the call.
Got their attention.
Yeah,
we'd rather
have
them.
We'd rather have
the money.
Yeah. I mean, I was hearing from the abutter like multiple times a day.
But what I'm saying is they got that for, they had that for several weeks.
It,
week.
By the time it went through all the channels,
right.
it was like 2 weeks.
So it should be back charged.
That's a good point.
Because they got away with it for 2 weeks. And they had they've used a lot of the piping that they were putting on the island, on that little park there. So
we're satisfied that they're gone.
Yeah, well.
Because that isn't an easy thing to do. And I'd rather have them be gone than collect the fines. So
Nick
really
wants both.
What I'm getting at is that this happens all the time. It happens with simple things like signage, you know,
right.
which can be, and it happens with dangerous things like this, where they get away with it for a certain amount of time, and then we sort of call them out on it, and then they take care of it perhaps, but they're really not penalized for having done it. They might be inconvenienced if they don't have enough room, but they've been working for a while, so I'm thinking they found more space for piping.
It's
there are big ones, too. It's like 60
yeah,
inch.
Yeah.
It's a tricky thing because it raises a question, you know, how involved in this do we want to be? You know, it's almost like a part-time job collecting the fines and this and that. We prefer to just solve the problem. But there's nothing that says we couldn't if we had the capacity to start delving deep into the fines.
I mean, did the neighbor complain right away?
Yeah, like the second
so.
Day. But then we had to talk to, we had to make sure that all departments were on the same page.
Yes, it was not an easy thing.
No. So. A few days went by, and then Glenn only works a couple days a week, so, you know.
All right, so we're going to define contractors' yards, so we're going to come up with some good regulations on that, some good rules for that.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we do have, in the table of uses, we have the thing, the so-called facilities for skilled trades.
Where is that?
Which is, has some of the constraints that we're looking for. But currently, it's only for the, in the commercial districts.
Yeah, so these are home occupations. So, mostly applying to residential districts.
Is a facility for skilled trades like a landscaping facility? I'm not talking about home occupation, but is that what that is? Because if I was a landscaper, I don't think I'd fit under that. Maybe I would.
Because you're not skilled?
I don't know. I that's just sort of an odd terminology.
It
facility for skilled trades. I'm not sure that.
It's like, you know, electronic repair, carpenter, electrician.
Oh,
I mean,
there's a footnote, number 4.
Yeah.
It says that it requires on-site garage for all vehicles and enclosed storage for all materials, if that's helpful in figuring out what it's for. I don't know.
Maybe. Not sure everyone would jump to the what that really covers.
It's
a little coded.
Yeah, I don't know. I've never even noticed it before.
I guess is what I'm after. What I'm saying is it seems coded, jargony.
Yeah.
Someone
yeah.
may not really get what that what we're after there.
Well, it's, I mean, distinct, it's the it's not a massage parlor, and it's not a auto zone. I mean, it's somebody who's doing the work on site. I mean, it's.
Do we define that?
I don't know. What if we do?
No.
We'll have to look into it a little bit.
We do not.
See if we really want to get into it.
Right. I mean, that is one of the uses that we added in the comprehensive revision.
Why isn't that, why isn't a contractor's yard that if a carpenter has, he's a skilled trade, right?
Yeah.
Well, that's why I asked why the contractor, why somebody thought contractor yard wasn't allowed, because that's what I thought it was.
This is in business and industrial districts.
Right.
Versus a home occupation.
A home occupation.
Okay. So a contractor's yard, this carpenter may just have a storage shed for equipment, tools, but he's not really performing a lot of work in the home. He's usually on site. Might be doing some smaller carpentry stuff and bringing it to the site.
Or like a landscaper.
Or a landscaper. But is that skilled?
Sure. I'm sure they, it's skilled.
Is that skilled?
I don't know if you'd call that skilled.
I don't
know.
Well, skilled trade means somebody that requires a license to practice.
That's not
typically.
A landscaper.
You can shovel mulch all you want.
Right. But if you're doing, you know, electrical work or mechanical or any of the other stuff, I mean, that's.
I think that's why this one needs its own kind of, it's outside of what you're talking about.
Right, contractor's yard and skilled trade are not necessarily the same thing.
Well, then somebody needs to explain to me again what a contractor's yard is.
And that's what we're going to do. We're going to
work
on that.
Right.
Okay. We'll work on that one.
Yeah.
All right.
You know, if it's just the guy's, if the landscaper's truck, that's just a driveway as far as I'm concerned.
Planning updates and other topics. Minutes. I didn't have any comments on the minutes that were in the package.
Oh, I had one comment. Hold on, let me find it.
Okay, so we have minutes from the meeting that didn't occur.
No.
No, this is.
The meeting didn't occur, so no minutes needed to be taken.
No minutes.
No, no, I understand, but the meeting that didn't occur was the package that has the minutes that we're supposed to approve.
Oh, we were supposed to approve. Right.
Yes.
If I can only find them. Okay.
Wait, no, which one are we on? 5-9? Then that?
Oh, yeah, so on the minutes for 5-9, under page 3, it says, sort of like the fourth paragraph, it says, Mr. Weston commented the commission should continue working and then go to town meeting when they are ready, rather than allowing town meeting to dictate the schedule. I think it should say, rather than allowing the town meeting schedule to dictate the zoning schedule.
Got it.
I don't.
Yeah.
I didn't mean to say town meeting shouldn't control our schedule, but the schedule of, yeah.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So.
Okay.
Okay.
That was my only comment on that.
Ready for the vote?
No, I don't.
Any other comments? Did you look up? Were you looking at them now?
Well, I looked at them before and I had no comments, so unlikely that I have any new ones.
Need a motion?
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of May 9th, 2016, as amended.
Second.
All in favor? We're still gonna meet with the BOS on the 21st?
Yes. Julie and I talked a little bit about ideas of how to approach this. The outline that we put together is more or less, you know, starting with an intro and a little bit of the background on where we've been on zoning, and then going into kind of what our thinking is for November. And the list that we've been going off of is what we've been talking about, the sign bylaw, the site plan review, minor amendments, and downtown zoning. And I think it's important to have some discussion about all of those items. The sign bylaw is probably the easiest to explain because we have this case now, this read, that we have to go by and we have to fix what's not working according to that. So that's probably the easiest thing to explain. I think the site plan review and the minor amendments, I look at the site plan review as being something that, you know, a couple of things have arisen and now we want to reach back to this and modify it slightly so that we're capturing some of those businesses that we've seen fall under the thresholds but create somewhat of a nuisance. So that's how I would frame that up. And then on the minor amendments, you know, to me that's more or less a general cleanup of some of the zoning that we've done, the accessory buildings, the accessory apartments. The big one in my mind is the downtown zoning. And my sense is that since that economic development plan really made a big impact and a big statement about expanding the 40R district, my sense is that the Board of Selectmen really thought that was a good idea and thought that's something we should be working on for November. That was back in, I think, December or January that they were presented with the report. then we started, you know, it was on our list, and when the meeting was held in April, there was a lot of, I think, the consensus was that, you know, not so fast with expanding the Smart Growth District. So I don't know that the Board of Selectmen has really heard that. And it could be that that's something that really has to have a lot, and we think we talked about the best way to present the information.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe the Board of Selectmen could say, you know, look, regardless of people's concerns, whether it be parking or whatever, our agenda is economic development and we need to move this forward for November. So I think it's very important that we're going to have this opportunity to have discussion with the Board of Selectmen. But I think that's something we really want to give some thought to.
Yeah, I think you're spot on, but the what we heard sort of loud and clear from the public meeting was not the existing 40R, but pushing for another overlay district to cover the Main Street corridor. And that's a lot of zoning craft to make progress on in time for the November meeting. Basically, it ain't gonna happen in time for November.
Well, but why can't we create these sub districts we've been talking about and tailor it to be something different than what's happening?
Well, the issue to a certain extent is that the 40R is constrained by the state. I mean, there are parameters that you meet in order to qualify for it. In the DHCD review, and there's a whole bunch of other things. As the on the mixed use side of it, with the existing zoning, I mean, there is a multifamily aspect to it, but I'm not sure that we've explored that enough to really understand it. Stand alone from the mixed use. And I'm winging it to a certain extent because it's been 10 days or more since I looked at the stuff.
You're talking about doing a mixed use, so residential, commercial, with all new zoning. Not like the mixed use one we took out recently that wasn't doing anything, had never been used.
Right.
That does what? That doesn't have the restrictions of the affordable components? Because then we're.
It would have to be, if it were going to have an affordable component, it would have to be scaled to the size. Because if you say, I mean, it's tough, because if you say 20% of the units have to be affordable and someone has two units, they want to do two units above like a small store on Main Street, and I mean, then really like one has to be affordable. I mean, there has to be flexibility built in, and that's no one's going to do that, because no one can afford that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because typically with affordable requirements, you can't round down.
No.
So.
No, and you need some density to make it work.
Right.
My concern
right.
is, you know, if there were one larger project, they could probably make it work. But let's say we got 10 of these two-unit apartments, 10 of these two-unit size ones, and none of them do affordable. We just added 20 units to
right.
our stock. You know, we just keep killing ourselves. And
yeah.
I'd rather see nicer units, too, but... afraid we're just gonna get a lot of smaller projects that don't get us into trouble. We have to at least consider that.
Yeah, it's a tough one to navigate.
Why does it have to be mixed? We don't think there's enough commercial to make it work.
Well, that the economic development plan did a market study, and they said mixed use is what you can support here.
So I ask you this, if, here's the thing, think about this. If we're doing mixed, if the goal is economic development, not residential development, but commercial development, right? I mean, that's really what we're talking about here. And all we're gonna do is develop mixed use buildings on sites that are already one floor commercial development, what have we just done? All we've done is added housing stock. I mean, it's not a bad thing.
Yeah.
It's not a bad thing, but that's not getting to the point of economic, of adding to the commercial base, because we're replacing the existing ground floor commercial, whatever it is, with another ground floor commercial and putting 2 units or 4 units or something of residential
on
top.
I
mean, that's not achieving the goal.
It's not increasing revenue, but it's potentially making those businesses more viable if there's some density there that can use the businesses. That's all it's doing.
Yeah.
It's that
yes.
symbiotic relationship between, you know, the post office gets redeveloped, now there's more people living downtown, and there's commercial on the first floor. McDonald's goes out of business, same thing. Commercial on the first floor, residential above. So now we're creating more of a walkable, sustainable neighborhood with a mix of residential and commercial, both benefiting from being located in the same place.
The other thing that's tough about like having commercial on the second floor is that depending on the type of commercial, you might have to put in an elevator. So I mean, there's challenges from both ends.
And then you look at the MF Charles building, and we always thought, great, there's going to be, and they told us, we're going to put commercial on the first floor and residential up above. And they came to the Smart Growth meeting at town meeting and said, yeah, this is what we're going to do. And then when they started looking at what that meant for parking,
they could do it.
They came to us and we're like, no, that doesn't work. And they said, okay, well, forget it. We'll just make it all commercial. So the business B still allows all commercial.
Right.
That's, they ended up not using the smart growth
right.
zoning.
Yeah.
So it's still there as the base zoning to do 4 stories of commercial. But what the market study told us was you don't have the office market, let's say, that you'd like to think you have in the downtown where there'd be architects and engineers up on the second floor. I mean, I think MF Charles did that.
Well, ironically,
that's
what's
up there.
I mean, ironically, we've got the business market or the office market on South Main Street, as we've seen from some of the buildings down there and the proposals that are going in there. I mean,
but
what
limited.
We're
and they haven't built that building yet.
And no one's really walking down there.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of office. Those types of offices.
And I mean, from a pragmatic point of view, the east side of Main Street is where the first level commercial with residential above is a walkable environment, because you can walk to Market Basket and the Liquor Junction and the other places where you can't get there from the other side of the train station. I mean, that's just the dilemma that we're in.
But right now, if you know, properties were for sale or turned over, like, say, if it was a McDonald's, you couldn't do housing there.
Right.
So what are you going to get?
Well, yeah.
Dollar Tree?
Are any of those doing any business?
Okay,
so we need to go to the Board of Selectmen and tell them what we've found and tell them what it would take to get to November.
And if it's not November, and if we're looking at what we need to do to accomplish the this goal of tackling downtown zoning, and you, you look at the, what's left for time.
Right.
You say, look, to do it the right way, maybe we need to have another public forum, I don't know. But we certainly need to roll up our sleeves and delve into this.
Mm.
And I think laying it out, maybe it's annual town meeting. If you know, November is just too quick, but at least have something that says we're seriously looking at downtown zoning. And
how long, do you know how long it took? Can you dig out how long it took to get through the downtown smart growth district?
It wasn't very long. There were two meetings.
Mm.
Well,
okay.
There was like a meeting in June and a meeting in, I don't know, I'll say July or August. Or there were two meetings really over the course of a summer. I came in September 1st. Then we had the public hearings here. Then I went to town meeting. I mean, there was a lot of back and forth with DHCD and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And probably a lot of discussion here. But as far as...
I remember a lot about it.
A lot of work here.
Yeah.
But as far as like what we did with the Zoning Advisory Committee, having 40 public meetings, you know, that was long. The actual public meetings, I remember being two of them.
Right. I agree. But from the time, I guess that's what I was saying, from the time we here started putting pen to paper of, okay, what's this going to look like, and going through all those issues and all the sort of concepts and sketches,
yeah,
and how does this work and how does that work, that seemed to me, that felt like it took quite a while.
It was
and
less
maybe
than a year because I was chair.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Finished it before.
So you
right.
must have started, say, in January, then went through and then had something in, I remember June sticking out as
yeah,
one of the
that
things.
That sounds right.
And then maybe another one in August or whatever. Because it was right before I started.
It
then I started
right.
September 1st, and then it went through the public hearing process, and then went to town meeting in November.
Because I honestly can't imagine that it's going to be any shorter?
It's shorter if we just expand the 40R. Like, why can't we do three districts? Well, the business is, the McDonald's is in business B, right?
Mm-hmm.
It's right there.
Mm, no, it's not.
Is
yeah,
it?
It is.
It's on.
It is? You sure?
Yeah.
Yeah. The railroad tracks is where the line is.
Yeah, it's not Washington Street.
I've
I don't
always
think it's Washington Street. I think it's the tracks or Ash Street, whatever that is.
I don't have
so
mine
on
now.
The website to pull it up.
Yeah.
But what I was thinking was if we could quickly do a 40R and something happened on that property, then at least that mechanism is available. Business B is available, and then we could develop this mixed use thing.
Mm.
That was another option if we felt that
do it in kind of segments.
Yeah, because it seems to me like the 40R is the fastest way through. It's already in place. It's just an expansion of it, right? Most of the language is in there. We like what it's about. We can tailor it a little bit and maybe get that through faster.
And we get the money.
If the units come.
In theory.
Yeah.
Did we ever get any money?
We did.
Oh, yeah.
We
got
yeah.
a lot of money.
School
children money?
Yeah,
B
it goes,
goes down to the railroad
yeah.
tracks.
It goes right
this is
to the right
McDonald's end. Is like right, one of these, right?
Yeah, it's that one.
This one? This one?
Yep.
Yeah, that one there.
Okay, yeah. So
it's
business B.
Oh, it's good. It goes right on to the right. That's where the district should go to.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, follow right along to there.
Because mm-hmm.
one of those is going away, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Probably not that one. If they were really pushing us to do something quickly, and we felt we could get the 40R through quickly, then that might be the only way to do it. Because a mixed use, a brand new mixed use zoning district, all that, I don't even know where I'd start with that. I guess I'd start looking at what we had before and not do anything like that because none of that worked. Or never used.
Just do the exact opposite.
Well,
the problem there was the square footages. It didn't really allow you to build anything.
Okay.
That was
marketable.
No. Okay.
But yeah, I mean I think that sounds right to me. Is if that's the, if we could tailor another sub-district of downtown smart growth.
Smaller parcels, right? Because these
yeah.
are all smaller. There's nothing big. The McDonald's one is actually a good-sized lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The
right one. Yeah. I mean, one of the reasons that we got through the downtown smart growth fairly quickly is that it was less than 2 years from the time that we did the Gateway smart growth. The Gateway smart growth was 2007.
But it was completely new language. We had lots of examples to pull from, though.
Right.
Okay. So those graphics that I sent you, do you want to pursue that?
Yeah, I'll look at those tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay.
I forgot to load them on the thumb drive. I'll have to probably, see how.
Yeah, and if we're, again, I threw those together really quick, but if the colors are consistent from graphic to graphic, then at least they'll understand blue means this, and they keep seeing blue.
Right.
Maybe they could read it fast.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You guys are aware of the two upcoming extra meetings? The one with the Board of Selectmen, I know, and then
yeah.
the business outreach meeting?
Yes.
Yeah, so like an event.
We remember... they're both on Tuesday nights, so we changed the date of the business meeting to June 28th.
Oh, it's my bridge night. Oh, well.
Oh, sorry. So Board of Selectmen is June 21st, and meeting with the business community, which the Reading Cooperative is hosting, is June 28th. And the June 28th meeting is like 5 to 6:30, so that's pretty early.
Oh, well, that's okay. Bridges at 7:30.
5 to 6:30. So that's at the Reading Cooperative Bank. And then the listening sessions. I don't know if you guys have been getting any emails on that. We had our first one last Wednesday at the Coolidge. This is about the financial situation of the town and what do we do going forward as a result of diminishing revenues and increasing costs. So that was the first one, and then I think that also sort of frames up the economic development discussion, because there's been a lot of discussion about, you know, how the town is lagging in economic development compared to some of our peer communities. And we're lagging because for a number of reasons, but mostly because we don't have the land.
Right.
Pretty simple.
But if we can look to other strategies for redevelopment and figure out ways to ramp up, I think that ties well into this, the ongoing challenges of a lack of revenue. So the other dates are tomorrow at 1 p.m. at the Pleasant Street Center, and then Thursday, June 16th at 7 p.m. at the Parker Middle School. And the time slot for the Board of Selectmen on the 21st is, thank you, 8 o'clock. And also after that, that's going to go for about 45 minutes, the zoning portion of the Board of Selectmen. At 8:45, 172 Wilburn Street, 40B project, the St. Agnes School project. They're going to give an updated presentation to the board. Their plan is to come in and file a 40B.
Friendly 40B? Friendly.
Well,
40B.
Technically friendly, but they're going to communicate with the town.
Yeah. I think what's going to happen is they're going to file for 40B like anyone else would file for a 40B. I'm not really sure what the Board of Selectmen's reaction is gonna be when they see it, since they have no jurisdiction and this is the Zoning Board of Appeals comp permit. I'm not really sure why the applicant is looking for their okay, but it's an interesting step.
Hmm.
We'll see what happens.
Is that condos or rentals?
Rentals, 20 units.
So they all count?
They all count.
It's not really a lot, 20 units.
It's
not that big a building, really.
No.
I mean,
no, but I think, how many units were they proposing when?
They were 24 initially.
When Ted came in, it was 24?
Yeah. I think.
I had my mind 26, but it might have been 24.
Well, it was 24 after he had the two, three bedrooms or two bedroom, whatever it was, the larger units that the DHCD was pushing him on.
Yeah, it's a requirement that in any 40B, you have to have 10% of the units as three bedrooms.
Right.
He didn't read that part.
Is he the one you referred to as?
Yeah, and they were gonna relocate units there from their other project. Mm-hmm. And
yeah, well, that was the kiss of death for his.
Why
yeah.
Can't he just propose a project and just build it as it's
Oh, that's
approved.
No fun.
Why? Every time he wants something from me now, I'm like, send me the approval for this. Because I wasn't here when it happened, and you modified it 500 times.
It's unbelievable.
Send me the approval and the plan reference to the approval.
With a file
like
this.
I can't, I'm digging through that. Like, prove to me you can do this.
I like that
that's
approach.
Fair. Yeah, that's definitely fair.
Okay.
Yeah, so I think that's pretty much all the news that's fit to print.
There were actually some lights on at Perfecto's.
Oh, yeah.
So it's not completely dead.
They're wanting a sign soon.
We
need to.
We like those up.
It's got to comply with what we have now, right?
That's not business B, right? It's business
A. No, that's business A.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I remember when we reviewed it,
it was round and
what I saw today was like an oval and it's purple.
Yeah.
Is that the same,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Teal and fuchsia.
Yep.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Because when you have business people grow up in the 80s or whatever. Okay, anything else?
I think that's it.
Motion?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
To wait for Rob.
We went. I went. We got back at 7. Greg's like, I'm tired. And I was like, it's pouring rain.
Yeah.
And I was like, well, it's right there.
I know.
So I went down and I got a lucky. Well, they were doing the raffle. It was like bumping. Like it was 7 o'clock and the last night pouring. But it was like no one was fazed.
Oh yeah.
I had to wait in line for food.
Of
which
course.
I wasn't expecting. Like I thought I'm gonna get there and they're gonna be closing up shop.
Nope.
Yeah.
There's money to be made, they're staying. I had every intention of going Saturday night, but